this episode of Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory, we'll look at the pre-dawn eastern sky and show you how to find these beautiful solar system objects. The planets Venus, Jupiter, and Mars. And Comet Catalina. All right, let's go star hopping. Star hopping. Star hopping. Star hopping. Hey, hello, hi, and welcome to episode 11 of Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory. I'm Dave Hearn, and I'm just doing cartwheels about being your host. In this series of programs, we'll show you the most beautiful sights in the night sky and explain exactly how to find them with your binoculars or your telescope. Well, normally we've been bringing you star hopping techniques to find deep sky objects in the evening, usually around the 9 p.m. to 11 p.m. range. We're going to change things up a bit this week because we have a new visitor to our neck of the solar system, Comet Catalina. This new comet is visible in the pre-dawn hours and it is easily seen in binoculars and small telescopes, so I felt that we should dedicate an episode to it. Since we're going to be up well before dawn, there are also several bright planets that we can look at. If you go to the effort of rousing yourself out of bed at 5 a.m., we better get some payback for that superhuman effort. I was really hoping to be able to show you an image capture from KPO of this new comet, but the clouds did not let up in Central Florida this past weekend. I hope to capture Catalina next weekend, which is conveniently new moon. As soon as we can get a good image, we'll post it on our website and on our Facebook page, so keep an eye out. So let's have a look at the layout of the eastern sky at about 5:30 a.m. on December 11th, 2015. As you can see, it's new moon because the moon is right beside the sun, which would be rising at 7:07 a.m. for the southern United States. Astronomical twilight begins in only a few minutes at 5:43. This is the point where the sun is 18 degrees below the horizon when the sky starts to brighten. This usually means the end of any astrophotography imaging run I might be doing at the observatory. As you'll immediately notice after getting outside and rubbing the sleep out of your eyes, the eastern sky is dominated by the overwhelming presence of Venus, shining at magnitude minus 4.1, lying in the extreme eastern edge of the constellation of Virgo. Aside from the moon and the sun, Venus is generally the brightest thing in the sky. If you ever happen to see the International Space Station fly over, then that might be brighter than Venus at its absolute best flyover configuration, blasting at magnitude minus 5.3. Last week we had a rare event of the moon eclipsing or occulting Venus in the daytime for the southern United States around noontime last Monday. Here's an image taken by my friend Tim Prinney of the event. Much higher in the sky is nearly as bright Jupiter, gleaming at magnitude minus 2 on the border of Leo and Virgo. It's strange to see two overwhelmingly bright objects in the sky at once, and if Venus wasn't around, Jupiter would be stealing the show. Jupiter and Venus tend to play tag occasionally. Here's an image of the KPO dome with Jupiter and Venus dancing with each other overhead. Situated between Venus and Jupiter is Mars, just about 8 degrees above the bright star Spica in Virgo. Mars is about as bright as its apparitions go, shining at magnitude plus 1.5, but in the presence of Venus and Jupiter, it just can't compete. Ah, but what was it we were going to talk about this time? Oh yeah, Comet Catalina. In this star chart from SkySafari, the tail is quite a bit overstated as the comet was expected to be quite a bit brighter than it is now. That's not SkySafari's fault. The astronomers just recently made some changes to its orbit predictions. So using the head of the comet image as its position, we can star hop to it from Venus. Be aware that a comet moves in the sky from night to night. So essentially, we literally have a moving target. This star hop is for finding the comet tomorrow morning, December 11th at 5:30 a.m. But if you miss that date, check out this excellent finder chart from Sky and Telescope, which shows the position of the comet for the next few days. We'll also be showing you some detailed positions a bit later, so stay tuned. So let's star hop to a comet using your binoculars. Starting at Venus, let's move 2 degrees up to fourth magnitude Kappa Virginis. Now slide about 5 degrees to the upper left to locate fourth magnitude Sirma, also known as Iota Virginis. Now we're right beside the comet. Move about a degree and a half to the upper left and you'll see a fuzzy star. Congratulations, you've discovered a comet. Well, at least for yourself anyway. Can you see any tail at all? We'd love to hear from you on this. If you locate Catalina, post your viewing experiences and what optical aid that you used in the comment section below. If there are enough responses, we can compare notes and I'll do a shout out to those of you that responded in the next episode. If you can manage to wake up early several days in a row, hard, I know, you should be able to find the comet moving a couple degrees to the upper left each day successively. It's a lot of fun to watch these visitors pass through our solar system. The closer they are to Earth, the faster that they move against the stars. So as promised, watch this sequence of the comet moving against the stars for the next week. You can do your own star hop by looking where the comet is and finding reasonably bright stars to hop from in order to find it. So what do we know about Comet Catalina? It's been given the designation of C 2013 US-10, where the C means a single appearance comet. The 2013 is the year it was discovered. I've not been able to discover what the US-10 means, aside from possibly the 10th comet found in the United States this year. I don't think that's it. If any of you know this detail, please put a comment below and I'll share it with everybody next week. The new comet was discovered on Halloween, October 31st, of 2013 by the Catalina Sky Survey, a pair of telescopes on mountains in Arizona. There's a 60-inch scope at the summit of Mount Lemmon and a 27-inch Schmidt telescope on Mount Bigelow, both in the Tucson area. The Catalina Sky Survey is an automated computer-driven system that searches for near-Earth objects, also called NEOs. These are potentially hazardous asteroids and comets that pass within the orbit of the Earth. Catalina has discovered thousands of NEOs since 2005. When Comet Catalina was discovered, it was barely visible at magnitude 19 and was originally uncovered by the 27-inch scope on Mount Bigelow. Comet Catalina is an Oort cloud object, originating from that theoretical cloud of icy celestial bodies, supposedly lying 100,000 times the orbit of the Earth, far away in the interstellar void. So speculation continues about the comet's final greatest brightness. Some are saying that it may be as bright as fourth magnitude, which is bright enough to be seen by the naked eye. In larger telescopes, it's already showing signs of a greenish coma, the head of the comet, with multiple tails pointing in different directions as long as a degree and a half. This is not unusual for comets as the dust tail and the gas tail are affected differently with the solar wind from the sun. Comet Catalina has been a southern hemisphere object for a while now and has put on a bit of a show down under. I apologize to our Australian viewers for that bad accent. I hope you've enjoyed star hopping around the Milky Way. We'll continue to bring you these astronomy tutorials every week on Thursdays. They'll be designed to help you find deep sky objects that are up in the sky at the time we post them to YouTube. The reason we create these videos is to help beginning amateur astronomers learn the sky and get more enjoyment out of their telescopes and astronomy in general. If you have any requests or suggestions of potential targets in the night sky that you'd like to see us present, just let us know down in the comments section below. If this is the first time you're checking out star hopping, and if you found this video useful, please consider subscribing to our channel by clicking the big yellow button down there. Click the thumbs up on the video, and please share this tutorial out to your friends who like looking at stars. I certainly hope you'll feel free to leave any question or comment below, and we'll be sure to respond quickly. We'd really like to get some great discussion going on our YouTube channel. Also, please follow KPO on Facebook, where we post all of our astrophotos and keep everyone informed about upcoming astronomical events. We'd love to hear from you there as well to discuss all this great stuff up in the sky. All the links to these cyberspaces, including our website, kpobservatory.org, can be found below in the episode notes as well. And finally, if you feel this video provides you value and you'd like to see more, please consider supporting us on Patreon, where for a small amount per video, you can support our efforts and let us make even more great astronomy tutorials just like this one. Well, thanks again for watching, and we'll see you next time on Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory.